considered the motions and the responses, and without elaborating further, lest my words be used against me later, I'm going to overrule the motion. I'm not going to grant a new trial on this matter. Prepare to go to sentencing at this time?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
All right. As I stated earlier, I have received the pre-sentence investigation report and reviewed them. Have the defense attorney been able to review the pre-sentence investigation report?
Yes, sir.
Any additions or deletions to information here?
Only that's it's set forth in our sentencing memorandum.
And let me start with Mr. Rook, Mr. Sinnenberg, on behalf of Mrs. Dreamer, would you like to address court mitigation?
Thank you, Your Honor. Mrs. Dreamer?
Yes, I do. Fine.
Judge, I have submitted, I think it's a 14-page brief sentencing memorandum that goes through all the factors that the court must consider with respect to sentencing Mrs. Dreamer in this matter, Judge. I'm not going to reiterate that. I'd like to incorporate that by reference, Judge, but just briefly touch upon it, Judge. When you look, and we're all familiar with the factors, our judge, and I would respectfully submit to the court that with respect to those factors that are set forth in 29-29-12D, which talks about recidivism, Judge, none of the factors suggesting that recidivism is likely weigh against Mrs. Dreamer. And all of the factors, Judge, that suggest that recidivism is unlikely weigh in her favor. With respect to the seriousness factors of 29-29-12B, Judge, and there are nine of them for the court to review with respect to whether or not this offense is more serious, it's our position, Judge, that none of those apply. And when taking into consideration and balance against those factors that must be considered as to whether or not Mrs. Dreamer's conduct was less serious, we would forward as she was convicted of in this case, Judge. And there are nine factors, Judge. We would respectfully submit that none of those suggest that anything other than community control sanctions are appropriate in this case. Now, Judge, you heard the evidence in this case, and we respect the jury's decision, but I think it speaks volumes that must be considered with respect to this court passing judgment on Mrs. Dreamer. Those counts in which she was charged with willful conduct, the jury returned verdicts of not guilty. The two counts in which she was convicted, Judge, reflect a negligent misconduct on her part. And we would suggest that the state of mind being much less egregious than would be in a willfulness go to and weigh in her favor with respect to whether or not community control sanctions are applicable, Judge. And not minimizing the fact that the election laws were violated in this case, Judge. Unfortunately, or fortunately, depending upon your perspective, there are no other convictions that we're aware of or we've been able to find for those statutes for which Mrs. Dreamer has been convicted of. So we can't look to that. But we have to take out of the context that we have all these television cameras and all the people looking at this, and just we would suggest just look to the factors that the statutes require the court to look at. I spoke with Mr. Baxter briefly before the sentencing today, and Mr. Baxter articulated for me, and I'm sure he'll articulate to the court, that he is going to suggest that a term of incarceration is appropriate. If he does, Judge, I would like the opportunity, before the court passes judgment, to address Mr. Baxter's remarks. In particular, I'd like to know what factors he is suggesting support a term of incarceration. Mrs. Dreamer is a 40-year-old lady. She is paid dearly already by public humiliation and by the loss of her job, Judge, already. I don't know what factors would suggest that Mrs. Dreamer should a message should be sent out that she should be incarcerated for her conduct. After all, Judge, we're looking at a fourth-degree felony and a first-degree misdemeanor, and I would only ask the court keep it in proper context with respect to the remarks of Mr. Baxter. If he is to suggest that there's an ongoing investigation, sentencing factors that we've addressed, Judge, I would suggest that that argument holds no weight, because in fact, it weighs against a term of incarceration. He's made public his remarks that she's granted immunity to these defendants if they were to cooperate in his investigation. And as the court is aware, Mrs. Dreamer gave a 6-page statement detailing her involvement in an attempt to offer a proffer to the state, and then rejected it out of hand for whatever reasons. But I think to punish her for failing to cooperate at this point in time, as I think the state might suggest, does not fall under the sentencing factors and is not an appropriate factor to take into consideration. So I would respectfully request that a modest term of community control sanctions, given Mrs. Dreamer's lacking place in a position where she can reoffend, is absolutely zero, given the fact that she's no longer in her position. And I think, Judge, that those people who stand in the position that Mrs. Dreamer stood in while she was an employee of the Board of Elections heard loud and clear the seriousness of any kind of misconduct, as well as the possibility of any sanctions being imposed for people who are Board of Elections employees by losing your job and having your name dragged through the papers. I think is enough of a deterrent that an additional period of incarceration is not only unnecessary, but would be far too punitive for the situation, Judge. So we're, again, not to reiterate, but we're hoping that a modest period of community control sanctions will be the sentence that this court deems to be appropriate in this case. Thank you very much.
Mr. Sandberg, did your client's statement to the state of Ohio include where she received any direction or who else had knowledge with respect to her actions in that recount?
It did.
Okay.
It did, Judge.
Anything else?
No, thank you.
All right, Mrs. Dreamer, what would you like to tell the court?
I'm not very good speaker, so I'm sorry. The past 19 months of my life have been unimaginable. I went to work one day, did my job, and this is what happened. Hopefully, with this happening, it has good, and that is that other people in other boards of elections will have more knowledge of the code that they're following because of doing it now. And, you know, I just think that, you know, it should be for other people out there that, you know, something good has to come with it. And I'm just asking that I be able to go home with my family.
Ms. Stringer, do you feel like you've given the state of Ohio all the information that you have, all the other people who had knowledge of what you did, all the other people who may have given you direction with respect to how that recount was
yes.
provided, you've given all the information that you have available to the state of Ohio?
Yes. I was not included in every meeting at the Board of Elections. It's been asked of me, and you know, whether I know, and you know, this big conspiracy, it's not there. I don't have it. I don't need to protect anybody. I need to protect myself. And I can't give you, for the prosecutor, what I don't have. I was truthful with him in the beginning when I met with them originally. I was truthful with them in that statement that I gave them. And to have them call me a liar and then even give me a lie detector test is terrible. And I did give them every bit of information that I had, to my knowledge, that I had. Anything that I knew, I told them. I have nothing to hide.
All right. Let me hear from Mr. Rotatori on behalf of his name.
Judge, during the course of the trial, we had an opportunity to watch the court sentence individuals during breaks and recesses, handle probation violations, quite a few during the course of the trial. And we got to observe destruction of property, anything like that? Absolutely not. Is Jackie Maiden need to be incarcerated to send out a message with regard to the violation of law she was convicted of? And I think not, Your Honor. She did her job as she understood it to be. Now, the jury has said to the failure to act and negligently acting that it was wrong. And we have accepted that. Jackie's been fired. She's been fired at a point where it's going to affect, obviously, her pension as a public servant. It's going to affect her medical coverage as a public servant. So she's paying dearly. Jackie's very active in this community, serves the community, gave the court letters from people within her community. She's an asset to this community. She's not a threat to this community. She's an absolute asset, Your Honor. And we ask that, Your Honor, impose a community control. Now, I'm hearing from the other questions that were directed to the other defendant, I can tell you that Jackie Maiden gave several statements during the investigation by the special prosecutor and during the pretrial process. She gave another statement under oath. And she's cooperated in every respect. And I want the court to know that. She didn't thumb her nose at the investigation. When she was called to be someplace, she was. When she was called upon to produce certain materials, she did. And it's just that again, in all honesty, the prosecution feels she's withholding evidence. And she's not, Your Honor. We've offered to have her take a lie today.
All right, Ms. Spangler, I want you to tell the court.
Yeah, I'm sorry for the embarrassment that this has caused. This whole incident has been embarrassing to myself, my husband, my children, my grandchildren, the rest of my family at the Board of Elections, my co-workers. It's been embarrassing to them. It's also been an embarrassment to me and my parents and my grandparents who couldn't vote. So I did not take my job. I never did. And I was working. I always worked diligently in my 20 years at the board. I've always tried to do my work in a way that people that work with me would be proud to say that they work with me. I have never tried to do anything underhanded or intentionally tried to do anything illegal. That was not only at the board, that's just my lifestyle. And this is also, I have forgot, this is also an embarrassment to my church family. I don't know if I said that, because I'm very involved in the church. And my husband's a pastor. And so my lifestyle is not one to intentionally doing things illegal. I tried to help Mr. Baxter every time he needed help, even when we have to speak with him without benefit of our own attorneys. And I was always honest and open. So I'm sorry for any embarrassment that this man caused. And I do ask for me.
Ms. Maiden, at whose direction, or whose idea was it to pre-count the ballots, check them against the official count, and then switch out precincts that didn't add up?
Your Honor, as I explained to Mr. Baxter prior, this was a process that was going on prior to my even working at the Board of Elections.
Pre-counting, checking the unofficial count?
Yes,
switching out precincts that didn't add up?
I never knew about switching out precincts.
Well, whose idea was that?
I can't tell you that. I don't know.
Well, you were the manager in charge there that day. Was it Mr. Santora's idea himself or Mr. Sinnenberg's relative, Mr. McAleer? Did they just do that themselves?
I cannot say. I was the administrator. I was not the manager.
So you're unaware that that was happening? A wrong thing to do?
We never switched out precincts.
You're not saying it didn't happen this time?
Well, obviously the court is saying it did. I said that when my statement, I said that I was not aware that it had happened. That was the statement that I gave. You know, lying was not a lifestyle. That's not the way we were doing it.
Your Honor,